Okay, our next speaker is Chiara Paletta from Trinity College Dublin, and she will tell us about integrable open quantum systems. Please, Chiara.
Okay, first of all, I would like to thank the organizers to be here today. Today I'm going to talk about integrable open quantum systems, that is an ongoing project with Marius and Balázs. First, let me introduce what is an open quantum system. So, since in nature anything can be isolated, we are looking for a nice way to describe the evolution of a system that is in couple with some environment. The system we are interested in is the orange in the picture that is characterized by a density matrix rho and a Hamiltonian that I identified with HS. This system is in touch with the environment, in particular with some buds or some reservoir. And the environment is given by these operators that are called Liouville operator or also jump operator. Under some approximation, the dynamics of this system can be described with the Liouville equation. In the Liouville equation, everything will act on an Hilbert space H. Here, it will appear the density matrix of the system, and these jump operator that I introduced before. And the sum will run over all the possible buds that we have in our system. Now, it will be very nice to write this Liouville equation in a form similar to a Schrödinger equation. So to write an operator that will act linearly on rho. And in order to do that, we can work in the superoperator formalism. So the idea is the following. The rho before was a matrix on some Hilbert space. Now it becomes a vector that act on the Hilbert space tensor, the dual Hilbert space. So in this equation, every time we have the product between an operator that act on the left of the density matrix, it will act non-trivially just on the first space. And every time the product is on the right, it will act trivially on the first one and non-trivially on the second one. So finally, our superoperator will act on this new Hilbert space that we can identify as H1 and H2. And here I just wrote which is the form of this superoperator. And as I said, 1 and 2 identified in which space operator act. And the bar is just the complex conjugation. This is called the Limbland superoperator. The interesting case that we worked is where the H is the Hilbert space of a spin chain with L sides. So this one, I just copied the expression I gave in the previous slide. And in this one, we considered H to be a nearest neighbor interaction, and L, that were, I was saying before, that were the interaction with the buds. Now the index A just became the sum over the site of the spin chain. So the superoperator takes now the following form. And given in that form, it will be clear that we can interpret this superoperator as a nearest neighbor Hamiltonian on a particular spin chain with a new local Hilbert space that now is V tensor V tilde. Here I put this picture just to help a bit the understanding. So we start from two chain, the first one with local Hilbert space V, this one with local Hilbert space V tilde, and we construct this new chain and the local Hilbert space is this one. In particular, in our case, is C2 times C2. Having in mind all this construction, we can start to work out our problem that will be to focus on the case where this superoperator is integrable. That means it can be written as the logarithmic derivative of an R matrix that is a solution of the Young-Baxter equation. Now I'm going to very briefly talk about this boost automorphism mechanism that Anton already introduced. So the question is, how do we find integrable Limbland operator? Very straightforward, it will be to start from a solution of the Young-Baxter equation and take these R to generate the tower of commuting conserved charges, so Q1, Q2, and so on. But since now we have this super operator, a very general form of it, we can associate this super operator as the conserved charges Q2. So we can, having this in mind, we can start from an Hamiltonian and L to be very general. We construct this super operator L and we identify this as the conserved charges Q2. Now we use the boost operator to construct the next conserved charges Q3. We impose that Q2 and Q3 commutes, and so we get a set of nonlinear differential equation for the component of the superoperator, and in particular for the component of H and L. Oh, sorry. And having solving this set of differential equation, we found a superoperator that in principle is integrable. I'm saying in principle because to be sure, we should evaluate also the next conserved charges to commute. But since this will be very hard to do, we computed the R using the Sutherland equation and imposing the following boundaries. So if we have the R, then we are sure that we can say that the superoperator is integrable. In particular, using this method and starting for a particular ansatz of the Hamiltonian and the jump operator, we found the following new integrable model that is characterized by the following Hamiltonian, that is as well a 4x4 matrix, and the following L, the jump operator. Here, this phi is just a real constant, and F is an arbitrary function. From these two, we can construct the form of the superoperator. I didn't put here, but if someone is interested, I can show. And from this L, we found the following R matrix. Here, we decided to put the renormalized version just for simplicity. So having found this R matrix, we are sure that our model is really integrable. And here, this theta is just the difference between the spectral parameter, and the capital F is the integral of the little f that appear here. We can also notice that if F was not there, then the R was of different form, so was only depending on the difference between U and B. This model is interesting also because it has a physical meaning. In particular, if we were working on the Hilbert space, these were the expression of the row as a matrix, and this one was just the will be the diagonal of this density matrix. But as I said, it will be nice to write the Liouville equation in a form similar to the Schrödinger equation, so we used the superoperator formalism. To do that, rho became a vector, so we can make the superoperator acting in this vector. And we can select, after having made this product, we can select the diagonal component of that. And what we can see is that doing that, we have that the density metric, the diagonal of the density matrix rho remains invariant under the action of the superoperator. So we really got a Schrödinger evolution of one vector. And the matrix W is given in the following form. And what is very nice is that this matrix describes a classical Markovian hopping process just in one direction due to the fact that this term here is one and this one is zero. So this tells that particles can only move in one direction, as very pictorially is put here. So particle can only move is on the adjacent site, there are no other particles, and it can only move in one direction. And the fact that here we have a minus one say that the probability is conserved. And this model is called TASEP, that is the totally asymmetric simple exclusion process. So using that method, we found this is one of the models we found, and we decided to show this because it was very simple and nice. So with this method, we could find this new model, and also we found that the TASEP spin chain is a subchain of our 16 by 16 chain. And thank you.
Thank you, Kira. Let's unmute ourselves and thanks, speaker. And now, please, questions.
Hard one.
Actually, I wanted to ask in Anton talks about this boost operator, which you also used to generate Q3 from Q2. So, what, how it was built? So it is the same as before. So, how to define this boost operator and why to define it this way?
Yes, basically now the method is the same. The things that is different is that we are going to start from an H and L that can be in principle any 4x4 matrix. For example, we can start for six vertex model for the L and six vertex model for the H. And then using this construction here, we can construct this super operator. Now, the step here is that we are going to identify the superoperator to be the conserved charges Q2. And we can do that because since these charges can be constructed from the R matrix, the index here indicate on how many sites the conserved charges act. So 2 means that it act on 2 sites. So the Hamiltonian can be a nearest neighbor Hamiltonian. So okay. After...
Yeah, can you remind like what is B in this case?
My question is
yes, sorry, I just put on some backup so it will be easy to show. So the idea is that from the transfer matrix, we can construct all the conserved charges. But if we have an R matrix that is regular, that means if you evaluate the R and the 2 spectral parameter will be the same, this is equal to the permutation operator. If R follow this property, the conserved charges can also be constructed using this boost operator. So the B in particular is defined in this way, but as you can see, this only works if the chain is infinite dimension. But it works also consistently if you reduce, for example, for a length 4, the explicit form will be the following.
Sorry, what is the HN and plus 1? Is it Hamiltonian density?
This one Hamiltonian density, yes.
Mm.
Yeah. Yes. And if you expand this and use the fact that you have some boundary, you can reconduct and find a nice form for a closed chain.
And it is uniquely defined object, yes, is B.
Yes, it is uniquely defined.
So basically the statement if Hamiltonian comes from R matrix, you can always generate Q3 using this B, which is given by just Hamiltonian density.
Right? Yes,
And then what do you have to check that it actually commutes with Q2, right?
No, then you would have a Q2 and Q3 that will be 2 operator that in principle depend on the entries of the initial Hamiltonian that you have. And you get a set of differential equations that can be, sometimes it can be hard, but they can be solved. Then you have this solution and you have an Hamiltonian. Now, you cannot say that this is integrable because you should check also that higher conserved charges commute. But we can use the expanding the YBE first order. We get the Sutherland equation. And this one will be other differential equation, but now for the entries of the R. We can solve this, and the solution will be unique because we can fix the boundaries as well.
Mm-hmm.
So we have the R, and so we can say that the initial operator or Hamiltonian was integrable.
Okay, thank you. Very clear.
Thanks. May I ask something? What kind of physical quantities can you compute for this exclusion process using integrability? What are interesting quantities like the
I mean, I haven't thought much about this, but I think you can compute the non-equilibrium steady states, for example, about this. And but what is interesting here is that this is a subchain of our 16 by 16 chain. So we found an operator that is 16 by 16 and was integrable. And just focusing on the diagonal of that, we have this as a subchain of our chain. I'm not sure if this was your question.
No, the question is just, for example, can you calculate in a given state the current through the system, around the system, for example, something like this?
Okay, I'm sorry, no, I haven't thought about it. I'm not sure at the moment, but I think it will be interesting to think.
I mean, it doesn't look like a usual system, the system in equilibrium, yes? Because all these particles jump into the same, in the same direction. It looks like a steady state rather than the usual quantum mechanical equilibrium, yes?
Yes. It could be due to the trick that they kind of double the Hilbert space. So interpretation and the initial system could be different.
Yeah, I understand that it's a matter of interpretation, but would be nice to compute something in this interpretation where it looks like a steady state.
I agree, yes.
That, is it contained in some of these papers which you cite?
Yes, at the moment, maybe I didn't cite, I'm sure there were some paper, but I can maybe check and then let you know if.
Okay.
Thank you.
Once they have our metric, they can build a state and they would correspond to this arrows, right? And that's what you need.
There is a contradiction in my head with the fact that for integrable system, for closed quantum mechanical integrable system, usually you look for the states, whereas there is no such flow, yes? You have jumps in both directions, it's sort of equilibrium. But here...
But what is very interesting is that in this kind of model, we didn't just find this TASEP model, but for example, there were also some other model that were just diffusive. So the W looked like four element on the four corner, or there were some also ASEP model, the totally asymmetric one that have minus one, one and one. So what is really interesting is that many integrable model have as a subchain some Markovian, classical Markovian process that preserve the probability.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm sure it will be interesting to try to...
Sorry, but you're right. So indeed, in principle, with the beta answers, you could eigenstates of the super operator, which would be sort of steady states in this case.
That sounds interesting.
That's the standard method to solve the problem, though. You know, the problem is completely understood. And it's, I thought beta transit is one of the ways to solve the problem.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think I may say something. So for this specific problem of TASEP, this has a really big literature. So here, I mean, lots of things are known from a slightly different community. So it is just a peculiar thing that we find this particular model. But I mean, in the bigger ideas in the project were to find all possible cases where this Lindblad equation is integrable. So we do not want to really focus on solving TASEP once again, because just this particular TASEP model is really well understood. So it was just one very curious thing that one of the solvable Lindblad equations is just this TASEP, which includes it. But the underlying integrability structure is interesting because this was not known. So TASEP is understood from XXZ spin chain point of view, but not within this Lindblad approach. So it is just a new connection, which is new at this point.
Yes, and also if I might add, only the diagonal sector of this superoperator gives the TASEP model. In principle, the space is bigger.
Yes.
This is the full superoperator looks like this. Then if we multiply this by a vector with all the component rho 0, 0 and so on, and just focusing on the first line, sixth line and so on, it will give the restricted diagonal that gives this matrix here.
But I think also a small comment regarding Vladimir Alexandrovich's initial question. For example, Borodin and the people, they look into this, what is called Q-test subsystems, and indeed they are able to compute quite a number. Actually, they identify the whole class of expectation values of different observables, including like thermal correlators and something else.
Interesting. But all that is just, it's rank one algebra, yes? The whole model is rank one algebra.
Why rank one? It's 4x4, right? It's SL4 kind of.
Really? I lost the track.
Well, 16 by 16.
TASEP is rank one, yes.
I think.
The initial one.
The initial one is rank one, of course.
Yeah, it's
You have just a few sites. That's why the matrix is big.
No, it was because it was C2, but then they doubled it to C4, it became SL4.
I see. But it's sort of a product of two SL2, yes.
Sorry, you start from RUV or from Hamiltonian. What is the sequence of actions? You study from R or from H?
We start giving an ansatz of the H and L. For example, I don't know, six vertex type for the H and just two element on the L. And then we imposed the condition under which this operator was integrable. And which integrable, I mean, we imposed the commutation between Q2 and Q3. And then we found the R using the Sutherland equation. So this equation here that gives the entry of the R matrix. And we found this one, and then of course we checked that YB was solved for this Hamiltonian, just to be sure. For this R.
Yeah, thank you. So we will have a discussion after free talks, and we can proceed with these questions. So now
how you found H and L?
This one here, we started.
How you found H and L?
No, we started from an ansatz from H with H, for example, H and L were both of them depending on six parameter, let's say. So you have H with six vertex, H1, H2, H3, H4, 5 and 6, and the same for L. Giving these two, we constructed the L in this way here. And then we said, okay, this L will be an Hamiltonian on a new chain. And we constructed, giving this Hamiltonian on the new chain, we constructed the Q3 using the boost operator. We imposed these two commute, and we had a set of differential equation. We solved this differential equation for 16 functions that were the entries of the H and L. And we plug back into our initial ansatz, and we got this.
I think here people are confused because usually it is proceeded exactly in the reverse order. So there is an ansatz for the Hamiltonian, and you have constraints that you need to solve. And from Hamiltonian, you are building up an R matrix.
Yeah, we are doing a bottom-up approach. So starting from H, we are constructing the next conserved charges. And then we are finding the R using the Liouville. So it's not using the Sutherland. It's not
at the same time also fixing the Hamiltonian. So.
What did you say? Sorry.
At the same time also fixing the Hamiltonian so that it is integrable. So they start from ansatz, then requires integrable, and then use this method to deduce R matrix.
Yes. So from after point three, you would have an Hamiltonian. And then you don't touch this Hamiltonian anymore. You use that as something that you know, and you use that to compute the R.
Yeah, so I propose let's move on because we 10 minutes.
Okay, yes.
Late.
for the next talk, then we can have extended discussion
yeah.
if there are still some questions.